morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Hebron and Methodist Church on this bright, beautiful morning. If you are a visitor with us as we get going here this morning, we ask that you fill out this little bookmark that's in the back of the pew. Put the information in the offering plate and keep the top for yourself for this bookmark. Also, please take a moment to fill out the attendance pads as we get going. And if you have any prayer concerns, the blue cards in there will be collected during the first set of music. We have a couple of announcements this morning, Ruth and then Doug.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I just want to thank everybody who helped with the rummage sale, who donated, who came and helped work, who done anything to help us. We had a little less this year than we normally have, but we still made $650, so we're very happy with that. So thank you very much.
Morning.
Good morning.
If you wonder what a wonderful aroma is in the church, I can tell you it is not the passing through aftershave. It's a large, I like making eggs too. It's a large quantity of food being prepared by the ladies to support our free will breakfast lunch at the church to support the Henderson trip in the fall. So please stick around, enjoy some delicious food and some fellowship at the church.
If there aren't any other announcements, go ahead and take a moment, pass the peace and greet your neighbor.
From the book of Psalms in the 100th chapter, acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving, go into His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever, and His faithfulness continues to each generation. Let's give praise to the Lord this morning in song.
I'm Let us be in that attitude of prayer. Holy and gracious Lord, we come to you this day, giving thanks for the day that you have created and put before us. Uplifting you, O Lord, on this day and giving you thanks. You've made us in wonderful and marvelous ways, O God. Ways that affirm who we are and how we are. Lord, let us learn more about ourselves, learn more about you. Let us grow in our faith that we might be the whole people that you see us. That we might become what you know that we can become. That we might grow into your very likeness, sharing love everywhere that we go. Help us as your people, O Lord, to uplift those that are on our prayer concerns lists, those that are in our hearts, those that are in our community and beyond. Let us take a moment now to go to you in prayer. And Lord, let us now say the prayer that your Son taught us as well as his disciples by saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day
our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
journey with some other people. I had a man, and he was headed for a town called Damascus. But anyway, you know, Saul was a very nice man. He really hated Christians. And he would just call them all kinds of names, and he would plot all different ways to how to get rid of them. He either didn't put them in prison, or he would just get away from them. So, you know what happened to Saul as he was headed down the road? Huh? Do you have any idea what happened to him? Well, all of a sudden, this big light came shining down on Saul. This. Now I gotta have a volunteer. And since there's one sitting right here, I know he wants to be a volunteer. The light shined on him. And guess what happened to him? No, he didn't. He went blind. Now, you know what? What happens if you're blind?
You can't see.
You can't see. All right. So we're going to put this on so he can't see.
No.
Okay. Well, So, Jesus said, called out to him. He said, take him on into Damascus. And he had to stay, he sat there for, for 3 days. And he didn't eat or drink or anything. He just sat there. And after 3 days, the Lord sent someone that could help Paul, or Saul, and he put his hands on him. There, see? There's a person that's put. And guess what? The scales or whatever was on his eyes fell off of him, and he could see. So Jesus said, told him to go pray. And he began to understand and like Christians. Well, he can't see without the glasses, so he has to wear them anyway. So, what does that say? Are you Christian? No? Yes, sure you are. And Jesus loves all of us because he wants us to love him and be the God. So let's bow our heads. Ladies. And bow your heads here. Hold your hand. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your Son Jesus Christ and for the love that you've shared with us. And that we know we're Christians by our love. And we thank you for all the things and many blessings that you've given us. Amen. Now, wait a minute. I have something for you. You're each going to get a light today. Now, don't shine anybody's face. But
6. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do."
God's word for God's people.
Praise
God. Would you be in that to prayer with me, please? Holy and loving Lord, let us never be fearful to confess you as our Savior. Let us with joy shout it out that you are my Savior. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, be pleasing to you, my Rock and Redeemer. Amen. How are your weeks this week? Good? Bad? Ugly? Any ugly out there?
Okay.
Okay? Okay. If anybody has experienced any kind of ugly, find someone to pray with you. Prayer is the only thing that can overcome ugly. Only thing. I'd like to try something. I would like to conduct a game here. Okay? We're gonna play a new version of Blurt. Now, last time it was this side of the church against that side of the church. Or if you prefer, this side of the church walking on that side of the church. Just point that out. Now, what I want you to do as quickly as you can, and I mean as quickly as you can, I want you just to blurt out that word as quickly and as loudly as you can, and the one who does it the fastest is going to be the winner. So here we go. Are you ready? You're all up for this. Everyone awake. Everybody counts. Now remember, this side, you got walked on last time. So, gotta bring it. I'm even standing on this side of the church for y'all. Gotta bring it. Okay, ready? Black.
White.
Black.
White.
White.
Red.
Red.
Blue.
I'm hearing nothing over here. I mean,
oh, yeah.
Are you awake over there? Now, the first word that comes to mind, blurt it out, okay? You don't repeat what I have to show. If there's a word that comes to mind, then you say it. Okay? First word that comes to mind. We'll try it again. We'll try it again. Black.
Red.
White.
Red.
Red.
Blue.
Blue.
Christian.
Catholic.
I heard one Catholic, and then there was one way in the back. What was that?
Love, I said.
Love. Love. Yep, I went around town this week doing the same thing with odd people that I would meet. I don't mean odd strange, I mean just the odd person that I've run into. Okay? And it was better when they didn't know who I was. They thought I was odd. But what I discovered was something rather interesting, is that of all the people that ask the same questions of just to repeat back what kind of what you just did, I had just about every person, when they heard the word white, they said black. When they heard the word black, most of them said white, some of them said gray. When they heard the word red, almost every single one of them said fire or something akin to that. And when they heard the word blue, just about every single one of them said cool or water. Those were two. But, and here's the crazy thing that I want to point out to you, is that there was no motion in any of those answers. They just, you know, just kind of randomly spit out words. But then when I said the word Christian, then the emotion came out. And I mean strong emotion. From everybody that I encountered, strong emotion. And the number one answer of all the ones that I asked, when I said Christian, the first thing that shot out of their mouth was hypocrite. The second most popular answer was fake. And it was said with anger. And I don't mean a little bit of anger, I mean a lot of anger. They were mad. And where does that come from? And I asked them, where does that come from? Some of them wanted to talk, some of them didn't want to talk. The ones that did talk, it was because somebody had hurt them who claimed to be Christian. Another person said it was because in the media, that's how Christians have always been portrayed. Another person said, well, you know, all I hear about is them judging other people. So I got wrestling with this week. That's in our community. This isn't someplace else. This isn't, you know, in it. This is here, right here in our own community. We have our work cut out for us. You know, what does it mean to confess Jesus Christ as your Savior? Think about that. Do you really consider it at all? What does it mean to you? How do you go about confessing anything? What does it mean to put your whole faith and trust into Christ? I mean, what does that mean to you? Because I really believe that whatever we believe, that's going to translate itself into action. That's going to put itself into some means that's tangible, that you have hands to execute. Your mind will think upon it. Your actions will dictate a lot of what you believe deep in your heart. Can we please put the scripture back up on the board, please? Now, let's see here. Okay. I wish there was a way we could blow this up. But there's one word in all that scripture that jumps out at me every time I see it. Now, have you ever done this where you take a piece of scripture, you read it, and maybe there's one or two words that just kind of leap off the page right at you? You've never had that happen? Oh my goodness. Oh my, well, we're going to have to try that. Has anyone ever had that happen where they looked at a piece of scripture and just a word just leaps out at them? Well, for me, the word that leaps out for me, and no matter where I stand in the room, if I'm back here and I'm looking at that, I still see it. I don't have to search for it. It just kind of jumps out at me. And it's the word way. Or maybe two words, the way. Way. He says in there that he asks for letters to the synagogues in Damascus so that he found any there who belong to the way. You know, he didn't call them Christians. That word didn't even exist yet. He didn't talk to them, ask, you know, about apostate Jews. He didn't describe them any other manner other than the way. That's kind of interesting, I find. You know, when I look at that piece of scripture and I see that, what that says to me is that there were a group of people that were living a certain way. Otherwise, why use that word? We'll come back to that. We're not there. So if there's a process or if there's a means or if there's an ability to do something that indicates that you are a Christian, shouldn't you be about it? I mean, if people in our own community right here have a negative impression of just the word Christian, how do you think they're going to think when they encounter you? Are they going to give you a fair shake? Probably not. I mean, if I'm told someone is just bad, it's hard to approach somebody and open your arms to them if all you've been told is negative, 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 negative. But then if you do that and you find that what you've been told isn't true, you come away with a whole new understanding, right? At least I have. So what are we to do about this? Right here in our community, what are we to do about it? Any thoughts? Should we change our actions at all? Yes. Be friendlier. Be friendlier. You see, when I look at this scripture and I see the way, I also am reminded that if there is a way, there also must be a way not to do something. If there is a way to do something, therefore there must be a way not to do something. So if we claim to be Christian, if we look at our baptismal vows, and we say these are the things that make us Christian, because this is what we say we're going to do, then are we doing what we say we're going to do and make it observable in the world? That wasn't rhetorical.
Yes.
Yes, okay. Well, one of us is. Good deal. You can't speak for everybody. You can only speak for yourself. That's a part of being part of the way, is that, you know, we are a group and it's a group activity, but each individual member of that group must make that decision to be a part of the group. Otherwise, it's no longer a way, it's just one person. How do we change this perception? How do we change this perception? You know, we have opportunities each and every day to demonstrate what's important to us by what we say, what we do, how we act, how we respond, how we interact. Every single day we have that opportunity. Every moment of every single day, it's right there in front of us. Bless you. Oh my goodness. Cuteness. I just wish we had a picture of that. This moment of cuteness brought to you by there. Just look at that. That's all right. I've had them all asleep during my sermons. It's all right. Just chill. It's okay. It's all right. But you see, if we truly care about the community we live in, I think we should care about this. It should matter to us, I would think. Because if we're about the business of serving others, if we're about the business of changing the world that, you know, it's all about bringing God's kingdom here. It's all about changing people's lives. It's all about forming behavior. Then shouldn't we be intentional about how we live our lives in the world so that when people look at us, they know something about us and it isn't just automatically negative? I would. I used to collect bubblegum cards. Did you collect anything?
Lots of things.
You collect lots of things? What's one thing that you collect? What?
Yeah.
What is that?
Spanish
figurines. Spanish figurines. They sound cool. They are? What makes them cool? Oh, wow. That sounds fancy. I need to see some of it.
Ooh.
Okay. So we have, you know, we have someone who collects these wonderful figurines with long faces. Now, is that the sum total of who she is?
No.
But if that's all anyone ever knew about her, then you would say, oh, there's the long-faced doll lady. You know, that's possible. That's possible. You know? What we do outwardly indicates a lot about, bless you, you know, what we believe, who we are, and it also can convince others whether or not what we're doing is something they might want to do. Now, if all that was known about her was that she was the long-faced doll lady, you may not have any desire to know anything about her more, because who wants to hang around with long-faced doll ladies? But, when you learn that we're talking about some really cool art that's resembling El Greco, and for anybody who doesn't know what that's about, look it up on the internet. Then you might think, hey, this might be really, really cool to see and experience something you've never experienced before. Likewise, if we carry a label Christian and it has a negative connotation and we don't do something actively about it, then what hope do we ever have of sharing God's word with anyone if all they think is that you've got to be a hypocrite or fake to be a Christian? See? It hurts us. We shoot our own toe off as we're trying to run. We stumble. We have an opportunity in this community to change poverty. It may not be huge change, but we can definitely push it a little bit. We can definitely move it off center just a tad. We can definitely have a big impact on the lives of a few people. But if those few people have a negative impact, a view of us, are they going to come? Are they going to look? Are they going to let us know? Or how are we going to go about it? How many are familiar with Christian history? Anybody? Christian history? Nobody? You people? Okay. Oh, he's awake now. Christian history, got him. All right. So, it may not surprise you to learn that we have a very long, illustrious history, right? We do. We have a wealth and breadth of history. And in that history, we became known for the way we live our lives, particularly in the way we care for people. We became known for the way we care for people. I'll say it again. We became known for the way we care for people. Unfortunately, we are now known for the way we care for people. You see, in our early history, we came that close to being wiped out. That close. In our early history, we had an entire world wanting to murder us. Take us out. You know, kill us. Be done with us. In our early history, we were not the favored group. We were a group that was due to be murdered. And many, 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 many thousands were murdered. But then three events occurred in the ancient world that changed everything. Three devastating plagues that some scholars believe took up to a third of the world's population. Three plagues, one right after another. Now, here's where the rubber hits the road. You're a Christian, you're living in the ancient world, and people are out wanting to murder you. Now suddenly you wake up one morning and everybody in your city is sick. Everybody's sick. Now for some people they might say, ho ho, God's justice, get them all. But that's not being Christian, is it? What made us who we are today is our Lord and Savior. When you claim Jesus as your Savior, when you claim that means you also claim all the stuff that goes with it. How you live, how you act, what you do, that you're going to walk a certain way, talk a certain way, you're going to do things a certain way. And that's exactly what the early Christians did. They took that word, put it into action, and they provide care, physical care, to the very people who were going to murder them. Now, if you can imagine that, do you think that could happen today? We have trouble in many places in our country just reaching out to people that are our neighbors, let alone people who are out to do us harm. Think about that. Paul believed in his heart of hearts that it was his duty to go out there and eradicate Christians because after all, they were no good. They were doing something they shouldn't do. They were disobeying God. And he was going to fix it. But then God gets a hold of him. Does God get a hold of you? Now, you don't need to be struck blind to get God's attention. But sometimes other things happen. You see, we live in a world today that is convinced that we have some ulterior means to anything that we do. We live in a world today that puts our picture on the wall and says, stay away. Stay away. And largely it's because of us. Do we even resemble what our ancestors lived? Think about it. It was because we provided care to people who were willing to murder us that our numbers grew in such capacity that we overtook an empire. And we've been growing ever since. How we live our lives does matter. It not only matters to our families, because how we live our lives ultimately affects how they're going to grow up. If all they see in their lives is fear, anger, hatred, greed, if all they see in their lives are the worst of humanity, they're going to grow up being fearful. They're going to grow up being hateful. They're going to grow up being greedy. They will emulate what they see. So what is that for us? If we claim Make those claims that Jesus Christ is our Savior, and I put it to you. Live it out. If you don't know how to live it out, open your Bible and start reading. If that's too difficult, then get with some people that can help you. The way we live out our walk is largely dependent upon what we put in our heads and how we practice it in our hearts. We have many opportunities to learn and to grow here. We have many opportunities to expand and reach out. We have many opportunities. The one thing that no one can provide you with, not even God, is the desire. That has to come from within you. Some of us might be fearful. Some of us may have grown up in an environment of fear. But you don't have to be bound by that fear. Paul wasn't. Paul became obedient. Now, I can't imagine what that was like to Paul. I really can't. One moment, he's out there, the number one poster child for murdering Christians, and the next moment, he's preaching the gospel. That would be hard to swallow, I think. That would be hard to get our arms around, I think. But look what he was able to do. He went places the others would not. He ventured into places the others would not. He reached out to people the others would not. If we hadn't had Paul, we wouldn't be here today. So what do you do with this? I hope you're surprised. I hope you're shocked. I hope, like me, that you're a little bit upset and angry. You know, when you're there wanting to serve other people, and the other people run away from you because they're fearful of you, that's a hard place to be. It's a real hard place to be. And the only way out of that place is to be 10 times as good. Be 10 times as forward-thinking. Be 10 times, because you've got people who are working against you. And sometimes you're even working against yourself. That doesn't mean that we have to be perfect or act perfect or be perfect. What it means is that we must be consistent. If we say we're about love, then let's be consistent about how we practice our love. If we say that we're people who open our doors to everyone, then let's be consistent and open our doors to everyone. If we say that we are a people who are there to serve others, then let us serve all others, not just those that we know. Let us be the people that God knows that we can be. I know you can do it. We have a tremendous opportunity right here in this community to do this. And I hope within a few years that if someone were to ask these same questions again when they come to the word Christian, instead of saying hypocrite or fake, they say away. It's up to you. Always, always up to you. Would you be in an attitude of prayer with me, please? Holy and gracious Lord, we give thanks for the day that you bless us with this opportunity of being together. Help us to live out our faith in consistency and sincerity. In the holy name we pray. Amen.
Will the ushers please come forward?
our meetings. In your wisdom, we discover peace. In fellowship together, we find ways to share your good news with others. As we enjoy your blessings, help us to give from our abundance with glad and generous hearts. We dedicate these tithes and offerings in the name of Jesus, the Good Shepherd, who laid down his life for this flock.
You may remain standing for our next hymn, Nothing But the Blood.
Created all things and called them good. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us. And through Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and our death, and you destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead the same Jesus who now reigns with you in glory and poured upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of the new covenant. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here on these gifts, that in the breaking of the bread and the drinking of the wine, we may know the presence of the living Christ, and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at your table forever. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Our table is open to all who have Christ's love in their heart. The body of Christ, broken for each of you. And the blood of Christ shed for us. We celebrate by intention when we take a piece of the bread and we dip it into the cup. You need not be a member of this church. You need not be a member of the United Methodist Church. You need the love of God in your heart. Let us come together this day and share in this simple meal. We have gluten-free options for those who wish to partake. Just let us know, and if you cannot come forward, then please indicate and we'll come to you. Please rise for our closing benediction. And the way to be sent forth from here to there. May the grace and peace of our risen Savior embrace you, uplift you, smile upon you, bringing you peace, hope, joy, love. May a Creator Lord, who made you in the image of God, put that imprint on you, where you have worth and value without having to do anything but exist, comfort you. And may a Holy Spirit, first working in you, to open your heart to be embraced by love, then work through you, where you reach out to the world, sharing what you know is true. Comfort you. Go forth from this place, embracing that love and sharing it with others, so the name Christian comes to mean love, hope, and joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and all of those people say,
Amen.
Holy name we pray, and all of God's people say,
Amen. Amen.